Welcome back to Anthropology. In this lesson, we are going to learn about language and communication. So in this lesson, some of the questions we're going to be asking are, what is language? Can language shape our ways of thinking? How do systems of power intersect with language and communication? And what are the effects of globalization on language? So first, we're going to talk about some basics of language and communication. So the goals of this lesson are to define and understand language, identify the way that language influences thought and vice versa, consider how languages reflect the past, present, and structures of power, and understand how globalization threatens language diversity. So what is language and where does it come from? Language is a system of communication that uses symbols such as words, sounds, and gestures organized according to certain rules to convey any kind of information. While many other animals have the ability to communicate, it is the symbolic or abstract abilities of human language that set it apart. We talked about this a little bit when we were defining culture. We have an ability to talk about things that are not present. This is known as displacement. We can talk about actions that occurred in the past or will occur in the future. We can also talk about concepts and ideas that have no physical reality. So these are features of human language that differ from animal communication. Human language is also remarkably flexible. Using established structures, sounds can be combined in novel forms to meet new challenges. This is known as productivity. So one light or loose example of productivity could be the term selfie. So it's a term that we made up to describe a picture of yourself. So we were able to recombine elements of different words to create a new word. So that is one loose example of productivity. So as I mentioned before, all animals communicate in some fashion, whether it be through chemical trails, pheromones, dances, clicks, singing, etc. One border collie named Betsy could recognize more than 340 distinct words and commands. Okay, so since we're asking ourselves, what is human language? Let's look into the origins. Where did it come from? As we've mentioned, language serves an essential role in human culture. It is a unique characteristic or property of our species, Homo sapiens. Or more specifically, Homo sapiens sapiens. There have been many scholars who have wondered how it originated, and anthropologists are often looking into this. Many times, linguistic anthropology and physical anthropology will intersect when we're trying to study how language originated. Even archaeology intersects with this question. All primates make use of relatively complex communication systems. So complex communication is something that sets primates apart from other mammals anyway, and humans take that even further with our language. For example, chimpanzees make use of many different types of vocalizations along with a patterned use of gestures. While these communication systems do not rise to the level of human speech, they are more complex than what is found among many other animals. In as early as the 1950s, primatologists began to wonder if apes could be taught more complex forms of communication. And as it turns out, Coco the gorilla and Chantek the orangutan were able to learn at least 100 sign language signs apiece. Coco mastered more than 400 signs. And their use of signs demonstrated some elements of human language, including productivity and displacement. So again, productivity was combining known signs to invent new terms. Displacement was the ability to refer to objects or events that are not immediately present. While they have been able to combine known signs to create new meanings and terms, these great apes in the study did not create completely new signs. The apes have also been unsuccessful in teaching signs to other apes. So remember, a culture is shared and learned. So if it doesn't spread within a community of people or individuals, it can't really be culture. And it's not going to get, most importantly, it's not going to get passed down to the next generation. So while the great apes in this study did learn some things, they were not able to come up with new ideas with their language, and they were not able to transmit it to other individuals or the next generation. So the variety of language studies with primates have clearly shown communication abilities that exceed a majority of other animals on the planet. More detailed studies over the years have been able to identify many key areas of the brain involved in speech. So first in this lesson, let me back up a second, we looked at our closest living relatives, the great apes, and what they were capable of. So they were capable of not the physical sounds of human speech, but they had the mental capabilities to use sign language and even combine signs to come up with new ideas and I think use displacement, but they couldn't take it further to transmitting it or coming up with new ideas with their language. So now we're going to look at ancient hominins of the past. We've looked at the living great apes. We're going to look at some paleoanthropological examples among Neanderthals. Excuse me. And see if we can learn anything from that. So what we see here on this slide is that fossil casts of Neanderthal brains have shown similar structures in their brains, thus suggesting human speech may predate modern humans. So what this part of the lesson is saying is that we have fossil skulls of Neanderthals that left an imprint of their brains on the inside of the skull or the cranium. And we can see that the shape of the Neanderthal brain was similar to our own. So the parts of our brain that cover or that direct language are similar in Neanderthals. So, and here's that physical anthropology bit I was telling you about. So Neanderthals weren't necessarily our ancestors. They were more like the cousins of Homo sapiens sapiens. And they lived from around 130,000 years ago to around 30,000 years ago in Europe and the Middle East. So another study here in understanding the origins of human speech came from a chance discovery of a family in Britain that had severe speech abnormalities. So these are modern day people that were missing something essential to speech. It was discovered that this family had a genetic mutation. They carried an abnormal version of a gene known as the FOXP2 gene. The variant this family inherited looks more like the variant that is found in chimpanzees. So what we've discovered from this study is that a long ago mutation in this single gene may have done much to open up the possibilities for human language. Okay, this is the end of part one of your language lesson. Please proceed to part two. Thank you for listening.